All right, hello everyone. My name is Dr. Joel Rosen. I am the Adrenal Fatigue Recovery Ninja, and I want to welcome you back to another edition of your Adrenal Fix. I'm really excited to talk to you today. We're going to be talking about how to finally wake up recharged without taking more supplements, even if you've tried it all. So that's a pretty bold headline, right? How to finally wake up recharged without taking more supplements, even if you've tried it all. So let's talk about that. So hopefully you guys are hearing me okay. And we're doing a great Facebook Live here today. If you happen to be checking in on this, give me a comment and let me know that you can hear me fine, because I want to make sure my volume is working. But aside from that, we got a couple of promises in here. So waking up recharged, how many of us feel like that Tesla that you plug in at night and you got to, you know, zoom up the batteries, you wake up in the morning and you don't have a charge. You're exhausted. You're burnt out. It's like, you know, when you come home with a brand new cellular phone or a brand new battery packed something that says you got to charge it for 24 hours before you use it, and you never did, and it just never holds a charge. That's what we're talking about. And, you know, what about taking more supplements? I know you go to your cabinet and you got one supplement after the next. You heard melatonin was great. You heard 5-HTP was great. You heard L-theanine was great. You heard Magnolia is great, or, you know, other types of sleeping botanicals are really, really great for you, but yet you're on about 5, 10, 15 different things. Or what about you've already tried it all. You don't know if there's anything out there for you that's actually going to work. And that's what we're talking about today. So how to finally wake up recharged without taking more supplements, even if you think you've tried it all. So first thing I want to talk to you is about circadian biochemistry. And I think that's really important, because we don't look at that when we deal with exhaustion, fatigue, being stressed out, not feeling like you can handle your day-to-day tasks, having deadlines, crashing in the middle of the day, feeling brain foggy, and just not doing well with your energy levels. And so let's talk about circadian biochemistry, because I think once you look at circadian biochemistry, then you'll get a better idea on how you can wake up finally feeling recharged without taking more supplements, even if you've tried it all. Because my guess is you haven't looked at your circadian biochemistry. And there's a really great book that I'm referencing a lot of this out. It's called The Circadian Prescription, and it's by Sydney McDonald Baker. I like to give recognition where recognition is due. It's an old book, so I don't know if you'll find it, but either way, you have me, and I'm the one who's siphoning it down to you so that you can get all the benefit out of it. And really, let's talk about circadian. So circa means approximately, and then dia is for approximately a day. So what's been found is approximately each day, a little bit more than 24 hours, our body goes through cycles, and our hormones go from certain highs to certain lows. Our body temperature goes from high to low. Our muscle strength, our heart rate, our blood pressure, they're all on a circadian rhythm. And it's really important to understand that. And until you do understand that, you're not going to fix waking up feeling recharged without taking more supplements, even if you've tried it all. You're just not. And so I want you to understand that there's something called a circadian biochemistry. And really what happens is, when we invented the light bulb, we ended up kind of getting disconnected with the earth, really is what we had. We have third shift workers. We have TVs and EMFs and cell phones and iPads and computers. And we have all this blue light that hits the back of our eye, and it really messes up our circadian biochemistry. And so I really want to talk to you about that, because I want to give you some clues as to why, you know, you're looking at this as, hey, I may have an adrenal fatigue problem, and I end up going to the doctor, and the doctor doesn't believe in there's anything called adrenal fatigue. They look at me like I'm crazy. They do an ACTH test and my adrenals work perfectly, or they do a saliva test and I have really, really high cortisol or really, really low cortisol. So if it's too high, I get myself some supplements to lower it. If it's too low, I get some supplements to raise it, and I still feel crappy. What's the deal here? Well, part of the deal is your circadian biochemistry is wrong, and you're not even looking at that. And so I want you to look at that. So one of the very first terms I want you to understand is something called adrenergic biochemistry. And that's an old term that a lot of doctors know about, and you don't hear about it anymore. But basically, what does it mean? It means that, again, your hormones and your circadian rhythm are in sequence with each other. And doctors know about this, where your cortisol is a very early morning hormone. It's really high in the morning. It's really low at night. And melatonin is the inverse. It's really low in the morning. It's really high at night. And all your hormones and all your thermostats, if you will, they go through different timings of the day. And the adrenergic biochemistry is when your cortisol levels, your adrenal levels, your adrenaline or your epinephrine levels, they're higher in the morning. And if you don't know about this, then you're not going to fix this. The other thing I want to talk to you about is the circadian ancestry diet. So one of the things I want you to learn from, if you don't learn anything else, is just changing your diet in this very way. This will be a really, really helpful tool for you, is because of our adrenergic biochemistry, it will force us to have more protein in the morning. And that's really important, because your protein is the prerequisites for your neurotransmitters, tyrosine, phenylalanine, even serotonin and tryptophan. Those are going to be had in your proteins, and also they're going to help make your enzymes so that you can make your adrenal hormones. And so what I want you to do is, number one, have more of your protein, or almost all of your protein, in the morning and no later than, say, 2-3 o'clock. And then on the flip side, the circadian diet sees your carbohydrates after 4 o'clock. And it's usually opposite, right? Like, you get up in the morning, you have cereal, or most of you that are gluten-free now, you maybe have gluten-free cereal or gluten-free breads, or you have a oatmeal, or you have a smoothie that has a lot of fruits in there and bananas and so forth. You shouldn't be having your carbohydrates that early, because that's also on a circadian rhythm. You got to think about the liver. The liver is a very, very important organ that helps us detoxify at night. And we got to make sure that we're getting these carbohydrates in the evening time, so that it can sustain the detoxification, it can sustain a constant level of glucose, so that you can regenerate, you can restore, you can rebuild, and you can reinvigorate your body. And that's almost opposite, right? We go with more protein at nighttime, we go with more carbohydrates in the morning. And if you didn't do anything but that, my guess is you'd get a lot of help just with that alone. The third thing is, we've lost communication. I mean, what do I mean by that? Well, we've lost communication with the earth, for one, right? I mean, we have our cell phones on us. We have that blue light. We sleep in, or we don't get a lot of sunlight. We turn the curtains closed and we turn off the lights. And we've lost communication with the frequencies of the earth. And you go camping and all of a sudden, you know, it's 8-9 o'clock or even earlier, and you're tired because you already have reestablished your connection with the earth. But I would also say, how else have you lost connection? You lost connection with the earth with the foods that you're eating. If it's synthetic, if it's non-organic, if it's food coloring, if there's a lot of cornstarch, or there's a lot of dead food, if you will, there's no information in that food to tell you about the earth. I know it seems kind of wishy-washy, but really your food is going to allow you to understand what's going on with the circadian rhythm, to get your circadian biochemistry working and to help your hormones. I mean, it's really that important. So getting back communication with the earth, with the foods, with the light, with the computers, and not being overwhelmed and being too lost in being communicating with the earth. The other thing I talk about is the genetic weak links. So you're not going to feel recharged if you don't understand what your genetic weak links are. So what do I mean by that? Well, you guys know about methylfolate and MTHFR. You already know about that. But what you don't know is that there's other enzymes that are important for making your neurotransmitters and breaking them down. And if you have some upstream problems, like you're not methylating properly, or you're not recycling your B12, or you're not recycling SAMe, or you're not able to recycle your DNA, or you're not able to repair your cell membranes, or repair your muscles, or make antioxidants. If you're not able to do any of that, then you're not going to make the raw materials that are necessary to make serotonin and to make dopamine. And that's really, really important. So you can try to get all the tyrosine or all the, you know, 5-HTP or all the, you know, the nutrients that you need, but it's not going to fix that. So what we do is we look at the things that slow down these enzymes. Number one, we look at these enzymes, we do a 23andMe test, and we look at all the weak links, and we basically X them out on the pathway planner and say, okay, here's weak, here's weak, here's weak, here's weak, here's weak. And then what we do is we overlap that with missing cofactors, magnesium, zinc, selenium, B1, B2, SAMe. These are very important cofactors. And then we overlap that with environmental chemicals like pesticides and heavy metals and candida and yeast and parasites and aldehydes and NSAIDs. And all these things are going to slow down your ability to make your proper neurotransmitters so that you can be in rest and digest and be able to sleep. It's less is more. Then we got to look at the microbiome. The microbiome is really important as well. I mean, if your microbiome is dysbiotic and there's more unhealthy bacteria to healthy bacteria, and or you have biofilms, and or you're not making enough gastric secretions to absorb your B12 or your iron, or you're not able to break down carbohydrates, or you're not able to break down and assimilate healthy fats, or you have overgrowth of bacteria and there's not enough healthy bacteria in there, there's not good prebiotic health or probiotic health or postbiotic health, then it doesn't matter how many supplements you take, you're not going to get that deep, restful sleep. It's really that important. And then lastly, overwhelm. I mean, we're all overwhelmed. We have these demands. We got deadlines and bills and relationships and people to see and places to go, yet we're just overwhelmed. We're pushing the envelope as far as we possibly can, and we have, you know, candles burning at both ends, and then we expect to just be able to hit the pillow and go to bed like a baby. It's just not going to work. I mean, you got to look at your life and identify what are all your triggers, what are all your stressors, what can you do to eliminate those things. I mean, it's really, really that important. So that's all the things I wanted to race through tonight. So that's how you can finally, you know, get back to your restful sleep without taking more supplements, even if you've tried it all. My guess is you haven't looked at your circadian biochemistry. You haven't looked at the adrenergic biochemistry, having more proteins before 4 o'clock, eating your carbs after 4 o'clock, you know, doing a more communication with the earth. Not necessarily hugging a tree, but, you know, eating real, you know, foods with real phytonutrients and phytochemicals, that's going to help your body get reacquainted with the earth, looking at your genetic weak links and doing a genetic test, looking at your microbiome and looking at overwhelm. So hopefully that covers it all. I don't know if there's any questions in there. But if there is, I will definitely answer that for you. I hope that you heard me. I never heard anyone say that my volume was low or high, but I'm hoping that you guys heard me loud and clear. If there's any questions at this time, I'd love to answer it. The other thing that we do when we do these Facebook Lives is I really like to try to interact with you guys and answer your questions and try to understand where you are with your health and what's not working, where you'd like to be and why you think you're not getting there. PM me, let me know if you're suffering and I can strike up a conversation. Maybe we get on the phone and we try to figure out what's not working and come up with a game plan to, you know, get you where you want to go. I'll leave a link to that underneath this video so that you can sign up for that. Any tips on when you're working night duty? That's a big one, Helena. you know, it's a tough one, I would tell you, is to try to not work night duty. That'd be the first one. I would probably say that, you know, making sure as much as you possibly can to eat the same way, because you can't out trick your circadian rhythm. You just can't. Like, you look at, everyone has bio individuality. We all have genetic differences. We all have, you know, stressors and physical traumas and emotional traumas, but we all live under the sun and the moon, and you can't trick your biochemistry in that regards. So I would still be looking at, you know, not having your protein at those times, you know, nothing after 4 o'clock and only carbs after 4 o'clock. That'd be the first one. You know, on a night shift, I'd also try to get out in the day as much as you possibly can. And while that sun is still shining, get that vitamin D and get the serotonin generated and so forth. I try to wear blue blocking glasses so that I don't have, as much as you'd look funny, you don't have the, you know, those blue lights hitting the back of the retina and causing your hippocampus to release more melatonin. Those would be some of the things that I would recommend. How do I feel about taking melatonin supplement at night? I think, is it Lina? I think that it's a good short-term thing, but it's not going to fix the biomechanical and the biochemical and the adrenergic breakdowns that are going on in the body. You can do it short-term. It's a great antioxidant. If it's good for traveling, to get and reset your circadian rhythms quicker if you're traveling from east to west or from west to east, but in going across the time zones. But I do a lot of 4-point urine tests, and I see, you know, the ranges should be between 10 and 28 for your melatonin levels. And I see people in the 5,000, 6,000, 10,000 levels, and that certainly is not helping them. So it's a short-term suggestion, I would say. So anyways, I think that's all I'm going to do tonight. I'm going to try to keep these a little shorter. I hope you got a lot of value from this. Make sure that you like this or you comment on this, and I'll go check back afterwards and make some comments as well, and leave a link where you guys can talk one-on-one with me, and we can get clear on what's working, what's not working, and make some suggestions on how you can get better. Anyways, my name is Dr. Joel Rosen. I am the Adrenal Fatigue Recovery Ninja, and I look forward to ending your adrenal fatigue nightmare. Thank you so much.